characteristics of her songs, especially the ones she explored exoticism. And finally, I will perform a few of her songs for your listening. So you see female composers from throughout the history of music, and women have been writing music all this time, but majority of their work have been underrepresented, unnoticed, and unpublished. The typical gender bias in classical music is that women composers compose mostly songs and short piano pieces, so-called domestic music making. This kind of stereotype seems to suit Chaminade in appearance. However, if we look a little deeper about her and read her biography and interviews, we can easily find that she was not fit into this category of domestic music making at all. In the following slides, I will share some of the evidence of her true feministic ideas about her career and life. So who was Chaminade? She was born on August 8, 1857 into a very wealthy Parisian family. Her parents regularly had a soiree at their house, and that was attended by famous composers, French composers, such as Ambroise Thomas, Guillaume Massenet, Saint-Saëns, and Chevalier. So at some point around that period, her parents became acquainted with Bizet, and he recognized Celestine Chaminade's musical talent when she was around 8. When Cécile became 12, Bizet recommended their parents to send her to Paris Conservatoire. Her father did not want to send Cécile to Paris Conservatoire since, quote, the bourgeoisie girls were intended to become wives and mothers, end quote. Cécile ended up having many private teachers from the Paris Conservatoire for her study in harmony, composition, and piano. She gave first concert at the age of 18. Since then, she became very successful as a concert pianist, and her programs were mostly her own compositions. She was popular in Europe. She gave annual concert in England from 1892, and Queen Victoria was one of her strongest and enthusiastic supporters. She made her American debut in 1908, playing her own piano concerto with the Philadelphia Orchestra. Cécile was extremely popular in the United States. She was the 1908 version of Elvis or the Beatles. Many American magazines and newspapers featured Chaminade and treated her as a celebrity. In 1913, Chaminade was the first woman composer to be made a member of the Légion d'honneur, the prestigious award by the French government. In 1901, when she was 44 years old, she married a Marseille music publisher, Louis Mathieu Carbonel, who was almost 20 years her senior. Fiancé mystérieux is a term used to describe the composer's personal life. It mentioned that Cécile's marriage was celibate, and the couple had a prenup contract to maintain their separate residence, property, and income. So none of Chaminade's close confidants could explain the reasons for the marriage. He died 5 years later, and she never remarried. Chaminade had strong feminist views which were well advanced for her time. In an interview with the New York Herald magazine, Cécile explained her philosophy, quote, marriage must adapt itself to one's career. With a man, it is arranged and expected. If woman is the artist, it upsets the standards, the conventions, the usual arrangements, and usually ruins the woman's art. Woman must enjoy her freedom and not suffer constraints. If she can consider fashion as having no importance, so much the better. But if she cannot, then she must marry someone who can appreciate her God-given talent and protect it. End quote. Yay, Cecile. During Chaminade's career, many French composers formed and influenced major avant-garde movement in Europe. For example, Debussy's Impressionism can be found in La Mer in 1905, and Satie's Neoclassicism in Trois Jeunes de Paris in 1888. Chaminade was reputable during her lifetime from significant publication of her music, excuse me, and performing career. Unfortunately, after Chaminade's death, she and her music were quickly forgotten by audiences because of reaction against post-romantic French music. Especially after the First World War, avant-garde French composers like Honorat Mignot, Poulenc took over the European classical music world. Chaminade wrote about 400 pieces altogether, and she wrote approximately 125 songs. Nearly all her works were published. Chaminade's songs are in a French romantic vein, graceful, sentimental, with rich harmonies and long phrases. She writes in the harmonic language of the mid and late romantic periods, even as composers start to experiment with post-tonality. Later in her career, she would comment to a friend that she could not adapt herself to modern music. There's not much of a stylistic evolution over the years, but there is not to say that these works are static. Her writing style was often compared to Chopin in her use of pianistic ornamentation, and this was noticed and commented by Franz Liszt. She was often criticized for her use of an older style. From my study of her songs, I noticed that she wrote the vocal part comparatively simple, but the piano part, piano accompaniment, was rather pianistic, virtuosic, and rather independently. Her songs display a very wide spectrum of musical styles and expressions. The range is from humorous to romantic to dramatic, but none of them explored high chromaticism or atonality. One of the styles that jumped out for me was that Chaminade explored exotic places or some place in distance in her songs. So, for example, there are Slavic songs, Sibelian song, Pyrenean song, an Amazonian song, and Hungarian song, etc. With her exploration of exotic places, she used the sounds of different instruments in these songs. Today, I'm going to sing four songs that she explored in exoticism, but you will hear that there's a big influence from Spanish sound. So naturally, you'll hear some of the songs she employed and tried to imitate the Spanish guitar or flamenco type of instruments. Now, all these exotic songs were written during the 1890s. So this year, this decade, 1890s, it was very important years for her, because she wrote nearly half of her songs during this time. Our first exotic song, Le Reuf, published in 1891. Can you see? I was trying to do the PowerPoint to describe it's about a dream. The song is less fleshed than other songs of Chaminade. Chaminade used impressionistic approaches to fit the text about a dream that stays briefly and then disappears quickly. And so before I sing, Then at a breath, wings open, they depart with the same song, and their place is empty for long, and long the soul remains deserted. On a beautiful day, happiness flies to us with a smile and dress in roses. One day it looks like a thing when a vision of the dream returns. It fools us again by opening the wing. It departs from us the next day, and its place is empty always. Always the soul remains deserted. I would like to say for you, Lara. Thank you. Rossini's Il Barbiere di Siviglia was in Seville. Like Vieille Chanson, the poem was written by Edward Dunant. And there's not much known about the poet. The most old Spanish sounds are in Serena Sevillan, which is the song that I'm going to perform for you. The poet wants to die near the river and surrender himself to the waves. The Spanish harmonies, guitar strumming effects, triplet rhythms clearly evoke Spanish music. I feel it's like flamenco guitar in the piano. The three verses escalate the drama each time it repeats, but then music remains the same for all three times. The song is operatic in a way, like Sevillian dance and music. The song is passionate and dramatic, and you can hear the piano accompaniment is very pianistic. Let me read the translation before I begin to sing. On the banks of the Guadalquivir River, I wondered one day when my soul was deeply upset. I had resolved to die when you appeared to me on the banks of the Guadalquivir River. On the banks of the Guadalquivir River, peace came back in my heart, so I stopped suffering from the moment that I saw you on the bank of the Guadalquivir River. I returned to the Guadalquivir after I realized that if I ever need to be away from you, I'll have to jump into the river. I returned to the Guadalquivir River.
Thank you.
refrains and retains the vocabulary of early music, like the oral tradition of peasant song. Respecting the forms and characteristics of old villanelle, Chaminade imitated the folk tune with grace notes for voice and folk instruments in the piano part. Chaminade villanelle is A, B, A, B, A, A prime form. The piano part is again very pianistic. I will read the translation for you. The splendid wheat has been gathered in. There are celebrations in the fields and the village. Every girl is wearing a blue cornflower in her bodice. There are celebrations in the fields and the village. The young people will dance this evening in the long avenue, and beneath the starry night sky, how hands will seek one another out this evening in the long avenue. This evening, dance until day to the merry sounds of your accordion. Young boys and girls, sing your songs of love to the merry sounds of your accordion. Without constraint and without remorse, become drunk with youth. Gloominess is for the dead. Happiness for the living. Become drunk with youth. Dance until day, there are celebrations in the fields and the village. Every girl is wearing a blue cornflower in her bodice. There are celebrations in the fields and the village.
Expression. So
Most of her songs are available in IMSLP, and her songs can be very good addition to a recital program for students and professional singers. Most of her songs were set to unknown poems, so translations are not available for study. So there are much room for research and contribution in terms of getting the translation and perform her songs more. There are many piano CDs, CD albums out there, but there's only one song CD that is published. This leaves, I would like to conclude my session, and I'd like to take a moment or to answer any of the questions that you might have.
Did she actually go to Spain? Because a lot of, like, Debussy never went to Spain, but we have all these, you know, pieces with Spanish influence. Did she go to Spain?
I don't believe so. She had the European, like, concert tours, but it was mainly in England and France, and, but I don't believe she actually went to Spain to explore all this, you know,
sound. Yeah, so, I mean, Netherlands did. And yet we have this great music from them.
Right.
It's very Spanish.
And the final came to Paris and brought.
That's true. No, he did.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
A little can I say?
No. Do you?
Your French was. Oh, your French was great.
Oh, thank you. So, January of this year, went to New York and recorded her songs for CD, I am excited to see the final product.
Did she write in any other language than French?
I don't think so. Yeah, it was all French. And I suspect that that was kind of the reason why her songs are not widely performed. Same thing goes with, you know, other female composers. They only wrote in one language rather than explore many. But
this is your niche. It's very interesting. This is your area to fill in, your niche.
Yes. It just came to me. I didn't know about the composer so well, but then I had this fund was available, and I received a grant, and I was like looking to see if there's any easy way out to record without having a permission or copyright issues. So I was looking at the songs before the copyright, you know, cut off year, and she came to my attention, and she wrote so many songs, like 125, and nobody really thought that they would record her songs. So I am excited about the opportunity, but in a way, you know, for someone like me who does not speak French, there's no translation, and some of the poems are very bizarre to understand for someone like me, non-native speaker. So I think there are quite a room for further research and contribution.
You're saying it's going to include all exclusively, you know, Chaminade songs?
So she wrote a lot of her songs were written for low voices.
Oh.
So that's why mezzo-soprano Anna von Botta, she recorded her songs, but it's in a low range. So I thought that it would be kind of unique that a soprano voice would sing for, you know, songs composed for higher voice. Yeah. Sir?
Where did you get your translations?
Those are my writings. So that's why there's some awkward moment, and I had to admit that I had to omit some things that did not make sense to me, or kind of make up words that I assumed that the poet was talking about that, you know?
So you do understand French, but you don't speak, right?
I think so, yes.
Did she indicate whether she wrote her songs with a female voice in mind?
she went through the whole catalog of her songs and, you know, kind of like gave suggestion about, okay, this song could be really good for tenor voice. So there's a dissertation out there talking about that.
I think it's really interesting because we have one piece by her in the flute repertoire. Very, very famous.
Oh,
right. And, but I never heard any of her other songs. And so we only have that, you know, one that's so, so well known and often played. So it's just really interesting hearing these works and hearing the exoticism and the Spanish influence.
Mm-hmm.
I never quite hear that.
Right. I mean, you know, like I didn't today, I specifically wanted to talk about exoticism.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't include the most interesting songs. But, you know, you hear that some of the songs are very, like, attractive. It's very catchy, you know, and, like, but, you know that you've heard it somewhere, but you cannot really identify where she might have borrowed the musical theme. It's just very friendly, and it's there. She wrote pretty good songs.
Yeah.
Are we good?